presence of God, as it's been here all day, I kind of woke up with God's presence. I told Mary earlier today there are different kinds of anointings. There's the teaching, preaching anointing I have. There's the research anointing that I have. And then there's the writing anointing that God's beginning to develop. All three are kind of blended together, flowing together, and I think God's up to something. I don't know if he's preparing me to do the conference this week in Colorado or if it's beginning for the next book that I need to write. But you know, probably the last couple of weeks I have been more aware than ever before of just how open humanity is for deception right now. It's some of the things that I'm hearing, some of the things that I personally feel like with the Mandela effect that's floating around on the internet right now, and there's a lot of Christians running after it. I think a lot of these things are psyops done by the CIA or some other organization that simply tests the waters just to see how readily people will fall for delusion. At the same time, there's a lot of people that are waking up. You know, as I'm watching, they're hungry for God's word. They're hungry for truth, period. You know, if you run for political office, just tell me the truth. You know, if you're doing this, just tell me the truth. And I think part of what we see going on, part of it is mystery religions, the mystery Babylon doing everything. At the same time, I think when the church quits being what God has called us to be to walk in the kingdom, that we can become an amplifier of deception because we're the only ones that can proclaim God's truth in the world. Now, I want to revisit part 25 of Understanding the Kingdom. Last time I taught this, the mic wasn't on. Everything's working right this time. But guys, we have a responsibility to walk in truth, to proclaim God's truth, and to remain balanced. And we look back, and there's the part of what we have in the Old Testament, we have in the New Testament, is for us to learn from their example and understanding kingdom dynamics. And so I want to revisit, and especially in ministry in the Old Testament, because we're getting ready to transition after this lesson to a New Testament understanding and seeing how this transition went. And so we have the book of Malachi with all kinds of things happening. God judges the Levites. God judges some things. And the replacement that man came up with with the rabbinical system wasn't that much better. Because if you leave man to himself long enough without a visitation from God to correct, we always end up back in mystery Babylon. We always end up in error. And that's kind of what we see in the book of Malachi. Now, under Old Testament ministry, there was the tribe of Levi that was separated out for use by God. Now, when you read the Old Testament, one of the things that God said was that all your firstborn children belong to me. In fact, he said, I want you to be a nation of priests. And I believe that was restored under Jesus, what we read in the book of Revelation, where it says, and he made us a kingdom of kings and priests. That's a very poor translation of the original Greek. And I hate trying to correct the King James Bible because people think that was the version that Moses used when he came down from Mount Sinai, that the Ten Commandments were in King James, and that Almighty God spoke Elizabethan English. Now, King James is about one of the more closer to the transliteration of the original Greek and Hebrew, although we have learned more things of the Hebrew since 1611. But this is really a poor translation because I don't think they could wrap their head around. You can't translate that which you cannot wrap your head around. It literally should read, he made us a kingdom of priests. God always goes back to plan A. But because they had rejected the voice of God, God says, now all the firstborn belong to me, but because of this, because of you rejecting my voice, I separate Aaron. And so if you have a child and you're not of the Levitical order, then you can pay a ransom for your firstborn child. If you didn't, then you simply had to turn that child over to the Levites for them to raise him because he was a priest unto the Lord. And so the Levitical order, as they begin to do that, the Levites' job was to minister to the people. After Almighty God had given Moses the Torah, he then turned it over to the Levites for them to train the people in the Torah of God. As well as they continue, they could look back at the life of Abraham and say, this is how you walk with God. It's not just theology. I've known a lot of men that have had their theology right, but they just couldn't really walk with God. They could walk with their theology, but it was the day in and day out, I think, all of us struggle with. That's why we have all these stories throughout the Bible so that we can see. How many know there's repercussions for stepping outside? That one of the things that we learn in the Word that for some reason this generation and previous generations have lost is what I do can not only affect my generation, it can affect many generations to come. How many know when Abraham went down to Egypt and said, this is my sister instead of my wife, and they picked up Hagar on the way out of Egypt, how many know that the world today is still reeling with the birth of Ishmael? We have all these different things going on. And see, the Levites' job was to teach the people the blessings that can go to 1,000 generations when you walk with God right, and the curses that can come to 3 to 4 generations when you get involved in pagan things. They were to teach them that. Now, you had within the tribe of Levite, you had the Levites that ministered to God, but there was a subsection of the tribe of Levi that were the sons of Aaron. Their job was to minister to God. That everything that they did in from guys, the shining of the utensils that were used in the tabernacle to the actual participation and all the different things they did, God considered every action they did as a worship to him. They ministered unto him while the Levites ministered to everybody else. So you had an outward expression and you had an inward expression or a Godward expression. But what we discover in Malachi is that neither of them remained faithful. They yielded to what everybody else wanted to hear, or what everybody else wanted to do, and they yielded to that which was most convenient. And you're walking in a world established in Babylon, doing what God calls you to do is seldom convenient. Ask any salmon swimming upstream if it's ever convenient. It is not convenient, but there is a blessing in the effort. Now, God begins to bring an indictment before them in Malachi chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. A son honoreth his father and a servant his master. If then I be a father, where is mine honor? If I be a master, where is my fear, saith the Lord of hosts unto you? O priest that despise my name. That's an interesting concept. Here their life is consecrated from the time that they were born to serve God in either teaching the people or ministering to God. And while they're doing it, they despise the very name of the God whom they serve. But we got to understand some things from God's point of view. God says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Now, we thought that started with Jesus. It did when Jesus told it to Moses. Because I had to introduce somebody to the fact that Jesus is Almighty God come in the flesh. They tried to tell me he was a created being. And then I have a hard time coming around the scripture. It says that everything that was ever created was created by him, and there was nothing that was created that was not created by him and for his pleasure. So was the first thing he did, what did he create himself? You know, you'd be surprised some of the phone calls I get and emails I get. But they had forgotten that God says, I don't care what you say. I don't care what we put on the... You know, God is not concerned with our PR. He doesn't read your business cards. He doesn't read your brochures. He doesn't read... What he sees is what's going on the inside of your heart. And he says, here's how you despise my name. You did that which was convenient. You stopped fearing me and you started fearing the people. Oh. Guys, we even get to this. I'm going to jump a little bit into the next lesson. The part of the, you know, all the controversy that you had with Jesus and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the scribes was who could get the most followers, because that was an endorsement of who was walking closer with God. Who was the most accurate? And so they would always try this one-upmanship to try to get in these arguments that was more politically motivated than theologically motivated. And the first thing, when John the Baptist, who was the trailblazer, he come out of the desert. God had hid him with the Essenes. And he did not go into the most populated places to begin his ministry. He was out in the backside of the desert preaching to scorpions and lizards, and people started showing up, i.e., they were abandoning the ones that had built the big crowds and came to where there was nobody, because the nobody in the desert was teaching truth. They were tired of all the garbage being preached and all the political things being preached. They're tired of preachers that look at demographics about what they should be preaching instead of hitting their knees and finding out what heaven wants to speak. Jesus did the same thing. He preached a hard sermon. He said, unless you drink my blood and eat my flesh, you're not getting into the kingdom. And everybody left him but 12. I can see the modern church trying to reinterpret this. And he turned to Peter and said, did you not look at the demographics and compare it to what I should be preaching before I preach the sermon? That's not what happened. He looked at the 12 and he said, you guys leaving too? If you do, go ahead. Don't let the door hit you, okay? Because he was going to speak truth, and the way he was doing things was in contrast to how everybody else was doing it. So what was going on in Malachi, because God judged the Levites, they were no longer looked at as the ones who were supposed to teach the Torah. This is Malachi is the authority that they had to begin the rabbinical movement. That's why Jesus was allowed to teach, even though he wasn't a Levi. Of course, from my perspective, he was allowed to teach because he's the one that gave it. Yeah. Moses was a good secretary. He faithfully wrote down everything I said. And now it's time for a word from your sponsor, and I'm here, okay? But we need to understand the motivation of why we do things. We can say we're doing it for God, but it's our diligence to exegete Scripture. It's our diligence to stay true to this that proves whether I'm despising God or loving God. There are too many that love the crowds and not God. If you make it hard, they won't come. If you make it hard, they won't give. But there's an easy way. There's a path. Wide is the path, and easy it is that leads to where? To destruction. That's where they were taking them. So, no priest that you despise my name, ye say, wherein have we despised thy name? Ye offer polluted bread upon mine altar, and ye say, wherein have we polluted thee? And that ye say, the table of the Lord is contemptible. You know, there's a lot of things that are going on in the church today that is contemptible. And man has made it that way. Contemptible in the Hebrew is bazah, which means to despise, to hold in contempt, to disdain, to cause to despise, to be despicable, to be vile or worthless. If we do not stay true to the Word, and maybe the hard way rather than the easy way, whenever we compromise the Word, though, that ministry will inevitably cause the things of God to be contemptible, because we've polluted it. And guys, there's right now the if you're not careful, you'll find yourself sitting among the prophets of Baal at Jezebel's table if you go down this path. And there's a lot doing that. Over time, the Kohanim allowed the people to modify what they brought before the Lord because it was convenient. It was polluted bread. It wasn't the best. It wasn't according to God's standard. Oh, I can't give him a spotless lamb. I'm going to give him this halt lamb. I'm going to give him one that's lame. I'm going to give him one that's blind. I'm going to give that to God which is defective. When all the time, every sacrifice they gave was supposed to represent Messiah that was to come. Messiah was not defective. He was absolutely perfect in every way. Guys, today, because of our polluted theologies, we have polluted theologies. You know how we got those? It's what I call situational theology. The Word of God says this, but somebody else experienced that. And so now what we try to do is we try to bend the Word to match their circumstance. Anybody ever hear when they lost a loved one that God was lonely and just needed them in heaven? I mean, no, God's not lonely. In fact, the very definition of God is He needs nothing. God's not lonely. He has all the saints before us already up there. He has angels uncountable up there. He's not sitting there saying, "Well, you know what? It's just never going to be the same until I get Mike Lake up here, so I'm going to go ahead and take him early because I can't stand for another minute." That's baloney. Oh, we take a few scriptures and we turn into a prosperity gospel. It's the Laodicean church. I mean, when these guys did this, we went from the basic understanding of God wants to meet your need. That's a great thing. But He'd like you to be a part of the solution, which means you start meditating on His Word and you stop doing the stupid stuff that made you poor and that went through money like it was water. And you start making decisions based upon the biblical model that brings blessing. When you get there, you don't need money raining from heaven. God prospers your hands because what your hands do is based upon His kingdom and His Word, and you begin working your way out of slavery from Babylon until you're free. But instead, we just do what the government does. Just throw enough money at it. And how many know there is a biblical truth to sowing seed? And there may be times God wants you to sow, but it's the Bible says in the New Testament, don't give out of necessity. What does that mean? I need a miracle! There is a direct link that goes all the way back to Melchizedek that the tithe and everything is connected to revelation from God. The teaching of the Word. So you sow, not going through the Christian channels like you're watching Ronco and trying to find out who's got the better deal. You sow into the lives of those who give their life to tell you truth and pay the price for telling you the truth. You sow into that, which opens up in Malachi. See, if I will not open up the windows of heaven and give you a blessing. You see, the greater blessing is not a brick of gold falling from heaven. The greater blessing is God beginning to deposit within you strategies to get yourself untangled out of Babylon and to get your family turned around and to get your heart right and to begin moving in the things of God. You see, the whole... Yeah, I'm not... The whole thing that... One of the reasons the Apostle Paul... It was not just about him looking at Abraham, that he was a Gentile, that God called out, so he was a Gentile that passed over. He was a citizen of Babylon. And one of the reasons why he was called is because he had the strength to obey God and to come out of Babylon. That is the call of Christ. Come out of Babylon. Because we have forgotten what people call church today is not church. Ecclesia, or Gahal in the Hebrew, those called out and assembled unto God. Called out of what? Babylon. And once I begin answering that call, the dynamics of everything changes. I'm not looking for money to come down from heaven. I'm looking to God to bless the works of my hands as I am faithful, laboring in His kingdom. I am looking for the Holy Spirit to work on Mike Lake so that Mike Lake is not stuck on stupid. Because how many know, if God would leave us to ourselves, we all end up in trouble. Mm-hmm. And really, are the modern... I don't know why I'm getting this. None of this is my notes. Is this okay? The modern definition, the charismatic definition in the 21st century of a miracle is you want God to instantaneously take you out of 20 years of stupid if you sow a big enough seed. How about coming to Jesus, surrendering your heart, and He go ahead and takes you off stuck on stupid and starts saying, I'm stuck on the kingdom. And as I learn, and as I demand truth, you see, I think what's getting ready to happen today with the remnant is we are going to defund the prophets of Baal. Not are we sick and death of the political garbage that's going on, and the stuff that's going on in a bought and paid for and controlled media, but we are tired of an entire priesthood that is built upon Babylonian infiltration and empowerment. And so we're going to walk away and we're going to defund that, and we're going to start believing God that that thing dries up and withers away. And we're only going to be satisfied with the kingdom. We're only going to be satisfied with the Word of God. See, that's part of what Malachi was saying. Listen, there's very little difference between you and the prophets of Baal, except you do it on the feast days. You do it on Sabbath. You do it in a name that the very way that you do it make His name contemptible. That is a violation of the Ten Commandments because you have made the Lord's name in vain. And there's a lot right now going on in the so-called body of Christ that is making the name of Jesus contemptible to humanity. I saw this morning where Jonathan Kahn had posted something on Twitter that said that the Church of England has taken the cross off their uniforms or whatever, because they don't want to offend Muslims. And my response back to him was, they just offended heaven. I'm supposed to offend carnal flesh and everything that is not in line with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's my job. We have polluted theologies. We are either tipping God when it is convenient or turning our offerings into a heavenly lotto to make God nothing more than a glorified Santa Claus. Guys, we no longer understand the dynamics of covenant and what it means to walk with God. We put on shows. And I mean, there are experts right now at putting on shows. Praise and worship is to be something in which you encounter the presence of God, not to be entertained with. And we have turned it into entertainment. We have turned listening to the preaching of God's word into a spectator sport. We want that preacher to move us, to make us cry, to have all this emotional response that does nothing. I am sick and tired of seeing people that go to the altar and 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 they cry and they squall and they do all these things, but they always stand up and go home and are never changed. I would far rather have a man be impacted by truth, and he may not shed a tear, but he may say, I have heard truth, and from this day forward, I decree before heaven and earth, I'm going to follow Jesus and I'm going to walk in truth. And he may not shed a tear. He may not run across the back of a pew. He may not even wave a hanky. But when he leaves that building, he leaves a different man that walks with God and will not walk according to the things of this world. Now, which one heard truth and responded right? So much of the church today, and what's going on, we see Malachi speaking to this in Malachi 1:10, part B. He says, I have no pleasure in you, saith the Lord of hosts, neither will I accept the offering at your hand. Can I put this before you? There's a lot of people mailing in big checks to a lot of ministry that God never considers an offering. Because it was given for another purpose. I need to get rich. I refuse to change, but I want God to heal my body so that I can stay in my sinful ways and do everything the way I've always done. I just want to do it comfortably. I like what Dr. Lillian Yeoman said. She was a medical doctor that began moving in divine healing at the beginning of the 20th century. She said, when I pray for healing and I pray for this, or I'm believing God for something, and nothing happens, I begin to change. Now, she didn't say, I sent in an offering, so what I got to do is triple that offering and send it in. You know, there have been people that have gone broke mailing ministers money because they were desperate to be healed. You're not going to hear, thus saith the Lord, send thou with a bigger check. Instead of examining their lives, looking inwardly. And what Dr. Yeoman said, if I begin to, where I'm at now with God, if I pray and healing doesn't come, there has to be an open door in me that the enemy is using to prevent that healing. And so I begin to look on the inside and change anything that is out of line with the Word of God. But the Laodicean church would rather just write a check. And for all of us that keep the feasts, Malachi 2 and 3, behold, I will corrupt your seed and spread dung on your faces, even the dung of your solemn feasts, and one shall take you away with it. Do you know, you can keep all the feasts and it be an abomination before God? Because what's going on in your heart? You can keep the Sabbath and be absolutely wrong about everything else. Listen to what God said about Levi and the Levites in Malachi chapter 2, verses 3 through 9. Because I look at this, and one of the reasons why I study so hard, especially anymore, is I look at what he says about here about what's supposed to be in the mouth of those who teach the word. He says, and ye shall know that I sent this commandment unto you, that covenant might be with Levi, saith the Lord of hosts. My covenant with him was of life and peace, and I gave them to him for the fear wherewith he feared me and was afraid before my name. That's one of the places I want to stay. The minute that I get afraid of what people think that I'm going to say, rather than being afraid of not doing what God said for me to do, I need to go ahead and just shut this thing down and go home. That's one thing that my old Baptist upbringing did bring me. I was taught when I surrendered at 13, when you get behind this place, you better be right and you had better only speak what God gave you to speak. That's not taught enough in seminary anymore. Instead, we're taught how to read demographics and how to please people and how to build a mega church. Well, they have New Agers teach them on how to do it. Verse 6, this is underlined in every Bible I got. The law of truth was in his mouth, and iniquity was not found in his lips. He walked with me in peace and equity, and did turn many away from iniquity. Then verse 7, for the priest's lips should keep knowledge, and they should seek the law at his mouth, for he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts. That's my mission statement. Right there. Mary will tell you that when it comes time for me to preach, I begin changing. There's a different attitude. There's a different everything that goes with my anointing. Because when I get up here, I am not a messenger of biblical life. I am not a messenger of Mike Lake. I am a messenger of the Lord of hosts. And I better be speaking exactly what the Holy Spirit has decreed should be spoken. And it needs to be that way for anyone who ministers the gospel, who teaches the word of God. Sometimes I'm not popular because there are some teachings that I do that people really like. And so they invite me to conferences and they want me to go back and to reteach something that I really like. And instead I'm giving them a fresh word, and sometimes that fresh word might spank them just a little bit. And they're not quite sure they really wanted to have me there by the time I get through. But my job is not to preach something old that I've preached before that you liked and thought was safe for your flesh. I'm a messenger once sent. Verse 8, but ye have departed out of the way. Ye have caused many to stumble at the law. Ye have corrupted the covenant of Levi, saith the Lord of hosts. Therefore I will also make you contemptible and abase among all the people, according as ye have not kept my ways, but have been partial in the law. Guys, that's getting ready to happen once again. That there are those that have built big ministries off of compromise. And I'm prophesying right now that there's an exodus coming. That the remnant's going to wake up, and when they do, no matter what the demographics say, their houses are going to become empty and are going to become abandoned, because there is coming a time that the remnant says, give me truth, give me the ways of God. Your job is to help me crucify my flesh and learn how to walk in the kingdom of God and understanding the kingdom dynamic that you have called me to. And if you won't teach me, I will go somewhere else. In fact, a lot of the remnant have done that. There are more remnant out of the current Christian system that don't go to church anywhere. There are more of them out of church than there is anybody in church. That if the remnant today across America would all decide to go to church, there are not enough church buildings in America to hold them all. And that's just the beginning. The remnant want truth. Guys, the Levites began teaching the people what they wanted to hear, not what they needed to hear. And one of the craziest things, and this shows you how crazy things have gotten in the church. Years ago I made the statement, God is not so much interested in prospering you financially as he is getting your heart right. And he will hold back material things for the sake of your soul. Okay? I had a friend teaching those lessons in a medium security prison. And the inmates that were there had a problem with that statement. They got mad at that statement. May I say that there are a lot of people right now that are in prisons that you can't see that would be mad at that statement. Because one of the things that Satan learned with Egypt, if it's a prison that they can see, if it's a prison they can smell, if it's a prison that creates lashes across their back, they'll begin crying out for deliverance. So you create a prison that they cannot see, but keeps them so off, it placates their carnality, and they become satisfied. We live in a prison planet that's preparing for the return of Nimrod. While they're preparing for the return of the son of perdition, I'm preparing for the return of Messiah ben David, who's going to take him down. And therefore, this soul has said, set me free that I might worship thee. Set my soul free out of prison. Even the ones that you can't feel. Oh. God, in the midst of this too, I thought it was interesting in Malachi 2, 11 through 15. Now, how many know that the Word gives reason for divorce? It's there. But God took note that carnality and treachery had become common among the divorce process. In fact, that's what Jesus was rebuking in Matthew chapter 5. We have tried to disconnect it all. He tells a story about how a religious leader began looking on another woman to lust after her, which caused him to divorce his wife, being the righteous man that he was. And then if it's his wife that he abandoned for the newer model, married again, he saw to it that she bore the stigma of an adulteress, because she had the audacity to remarry, even though he did, because there was a double standard. We see that double standard also. Remember when they brought the woman who was caught in the act of adultery? I thought it took two to tango. Where was the guy? I always wonder what Jesus wrote in the dirt. The only record of Jesus ever writing anything, and we don't know what it was. I wonder if all those men that had stones, if Jesus wrote all the ones they were having affairs with, the names of their girlfriends. You kind of wonder, don't you? But God took note that their carnality many times is what causes divorce. Now there's ones that when they violate covenant, they don't want to walk with God, you got to let them go. Although the church today believes that it's not the sin of the Holy Spirit, blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, it's the unpardonable sin, it's something called divorce. You know, they kind of freak out when you tell them God's divorced. He divorced Israel, the northern tribes. He said, I divorce you. We got to come back to biblical balance, don't we? Where are we today? Malachi 2:17. Ye have wearied the Lord with your words. Mike, I pray all the time. What do you pray? Gimme, 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 gimme. How many of you as parents, if every word out of your child's mouth was give me, you wouldn't get weary of that after a while? God help us for the children that learn this secret. You love and dote on mom and dad and disappreciate them for who they are, you'd be surprised how quick their wallets open up. Oh, Father. Come on now. If you have a little child, that comes up and snuggles with you and just loves on you and everything else, how many know y'all, next thing you know is that, you know what? I'm going to get him that whatever it was he was looking at Walmart the other day. Because he's not seeking that. He wants relationship, or she wants relationship. But we have wearied God for our constantly wanting to be Laodicea, to prove that we're something. When God says, you can be like Abraham that walked out and left everything and prove everything of the kingdom of God. Yet ye say, wherein have we wearied him? When ye say, every one that doeth evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delighteth in them, or where is the judgment of God? In other words, we can get away with it. Right now, God's weary about a lot of things that are going on in the world today. God's weary about a lot of things that are going on in the church today. Here's the state of our nation. Picking up in verse 13 of Malachi chapter 3. Your words have been stout against me, saith the Lord, yet ye say, wherein have we spoken so much against thee? Ye have said, it is vain to serve God. And what profit is it that we have kept his ordinance, and that we have walked mournfully before the Lord of hosts? And now you call the proud happy, yea, ye that work wickedness are set up, yea, they that tempt God are even delivered. I thought this was an interesting verse to even utter out of my mouth with seeing what happened with the FBI this week. Saw an interesting post on Facebook this morning. It had a picture of Agent Molnar from the X-Files, and it says, now he's the only FBI agent that we can trust. There's something about Sodom and Gomorrah no one ever talks about. Now, whenever preachers preach about Sodom and Gomorrah, they get into sodomy and preach about that. Not even knowing that the reason that those men want a relationship with those angels is because they knew they were angels. Not just men, but angels. And knowingly, they wanted to increase their occult power, which when you go so far up in the Illuminati, you go so far up in the occult, there is a threshold that you can only go over after entering into sexual union with an angel. Fallen angel. Those preachers don't know that. But also what happened in Sodom and Gomorrah is they perverted and corrupted justice. God talks about that a lot in the prophets. They had forgotten the poor. They used the poor for their agenda while never really taking care of the poor. Does that sound familiar? In fact, the rabbis talk about that if someone poor wandered into Sodom and Gomorrah that was on the point of starving to death, they would give them money. But nobody would sell them food. So they would die of starvation with money in their pockets. The perverting of justice. That perverting of justice is one of the reasons why God judged them. Because those who did evil prospered to the point that people begin to say it's worthless to follow God. Do you kind of feel like that with what's going on in this nation right now? Do you feel like that with what's going on in Europe right now? Do you feel like that, that even though Britain has elected to leave the EU, they're not letting them? And even their own leaders, who the elite have the hook in the jaw, are saying, maybe you better rethink this. What really shocked Mary and I is that even the news media are calling them the elite. Unelected rulers. Tyrants. Whose emblem is the Tower of Babel for the EU. And they long to be like Nimrod. But where are we? Oh, you gotta keep reading. I like the word, you gotta keep reading here. Let's not stop there. Because here's where we are. I said all of that to get to verse 16. Then they that feared the Lord spoke one to another, and the Lord hearkened, and he heard it. Guys, there's a lot of us that are talking on podcasts, on Hagman and Hagman, and on Skywatch TV, and on the Jim Baker Show, and just a lot of other shows, where we're sharing our brokenness at what's going on. And let me tell you something, people aren't the only ones that are listening to those shows. God is. God hearkened and heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. Oh, I like what... If you have a pen, start underlining in verse 17 right here. And they shall be mine, saith the Lord. The Lord is marking and numbering the remnant. Whew. I feel almost like a podcast coming on, Mary. Oh, if you haven't listened to this week's podcast, she did her thing and turned to me, and I looked at my notes and looked at her and went, we had a cry cast this last week talking about the potter's field and the revelation with that. God, when we start talking and say, this isn't right, this isn't justice, this is not holy, this is contemptible to me, God says, I hear what you're saying. Now, I'm getting ready to do some stuff, but in the midst of me doing some stuff, I want you to know that when I look over the earth, you will be mine. The devil can't have you. Babylon can't have you. Nimrod cannot have you. Because while everybody else was pointing toward Babylon, you were pointing toward Jerusalem. You're pointing back to the ways of God. They shall be mine, saith the Lord, in the day when I make up my jewels, I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. Then shall ye return and discern. Hear this, remnant. Then ye shall return and discern. Turn to your neighbor and say, there's some discernment coming. There's discernment coming to the remnant. That you can use all the flattering words in the world and the remnant will look at you and say, you are a BS dispenser. Because how will the Antichrist get all the world to follow? Flattering words. Then shall ye return and discern between the righteous and the wicked, and between him that serveth God and him that serveth him not. You see, I don't care what people say they go to church. I don't care. Every politician gets religion around election time. You shall know them by their fruits. not about what they say at election time. And there's some politicians that claim to be members of certain churches and certain denominations, and let me tell you something, right now, they're the very reason why Ichabod should be written over the doorpost of those denominations. If that's what you produce, hell welcometh you. You're loosing hell upon the earth. If what you preach produces that, we don't need none of it. As I was putting this together the first time, but God reemphasized it this time, God said in our generation, there is a new book of remembrance that has been opened for the remnant. In other words, God's taken names so that He knows who are His. You see, what this is God is coming down. Now that ought to strike heart in the fear of Babylon. Because there was a guy named Nimrod who built a tower that would reach unto heaven. And he said, I will make a name for myself. And God came down. And they scattered 72 ways. There have been strategic places in history where God has come down, and God is about ready to come down, and the cockroaches are about ready to start running. But God is taking the names of those who fear Him, who long after truth, who are grieved. You see, what causes the remnant to be different is that sin has always been in the world since Adam and Eve. What separates someone really walking with God is they are grieved at the sinfulness of the world. They're not worried about how to tap into that demographics to expand what they're doing. They're grieved at it and want to call people out of Babylon. You see, we're getting ready to enter into a time of spot judgment. And guys, if the remnant does it right, if the remnant does it right, my Bible says that it is the tares that are to be gathered up, not the wheat. It's the tares that are cut down. It's the tares that are burned. That we could see a return to the ways of God in America while the elite are judged. And Father, I say, judge them. Let everything they have ever sown, if they won't renounce Lucifer and embrace Jesus and the truth of the cross, and let the blood of Jesus set them free of the iniquity force, for the sake of the remnant, judge them. Because God is not done with His people yet. There has to be an end time dichotomy. This is right. This is wrong. This is God. This is not. This is truth. And this is a lie. Because then we can have that final revival and God can get His final harvest in, because they clearly see Jesus and they clearly see the lie. And that's supposed to be done through us. And so, Father, let us. That's why Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. Oh, that's almost in my next book. You see, the one that's getting ready to come out, I introduced the iniquity force. But there's another force. One comes from the throne of God. It's called the force of righteousness. That radiates from the breastplate of righteousness, from the armor of God. When men and women fear the name of God and walk reverently before God and choose righteousness and not to lend their members unto sin. Don't power the devil's kingdom through carnality, but instead become a channel that the river of God can flow through you into the earth to a people that are thirsty and dying in a dry land. Father, we just thank you for your word today. Father, I thank you it will not return to you void. And Father, you're going to start judging ministries. You're going to start judging from that which has been called ministry, but is not. And Father, let us lay down the concept of building mega churches. And Father, let us pick up the standard of preparing and training the remnant to be the special forces and the army in the kingdom of God in these last days. And Father, for these things, we just give you the praise. We give you the glory. We give you the honor. And we give you the respect that your name is due. In Jesus' name.